yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. 100%. Because I believe, like, once someone creates something, whether it be music, video games, you know, films, whatever, it's art. Whatever you create, if someone sets down to make something, I believe in it's art, basically.
For me, film, it's not just... The whole process is an art. You get sound, editing, camera work, the actors, the directors.
Yeah.
It's like all these people who do different arts come together to create this one giant piece.
Yeah.
I think that's amazing.
Such the cinematography issues, the lighting, the brightness, darkness, style of editing.
It's all like a separate art that comes together to make one big art.
One big art piece, basically. Yeah. I mean, like, I
need to work together, because the camera person needs to know how to get those angles, and the director needs to know, he needs to know how to speak to the camera person, what way they want it filmed. I mean, the camera person, it's basically kind of like a joint thing.
Oh,
they both need to work together to understand what each other's vision is.
Because if the director has like
poor communication skills,
I want you to do this,
and then the camera guy, well, I don't really know how to do that, can you explain it a bit better? But the director doesn't know how to do it, well, then that's like, kind of mismatch. Like, you need to be able to understand each other.
I don't think there's many films out there that there's good examples of that, you know. But I think it is definitely a joint operation between the two.
Especially when it comes to low quality cameras like mobile phones.
Yeah.
You know, compared to NEX.
Mm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you're gonna see the quality difference. You know?
There's times where it feels like that, but now there's a lot more creativity with certain directors you can find, like, you know, we've got Fincher, we've got Tarantino still around, Martin Scorsese changing his, because Martin Scorsese, like, he usually sticks to a certain genre, and then his new film completely, it was completely different from anything he's ever done.
That's right.
About kind of like religion and history. Most of his films are gangster films.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
I feel like he wasn't able to do that years ago. But now, because, you know, he's got his name out there and he's able to be more creative in the industry, I do feel like it's evolved a lot. You are allowed to make movies that are more slow paced now, when back then needed to have action in them.
Yeah, because I believe that, like, you know, things like Gone Girl or Girl with a Dragon Tattoo couldn't have been made 20 years ago, because people wouldn't have had the attention spot. Yeah, no one would.
They wouldn't have wanted to pay attention to it.
Yeah. I think it's too much of a slow burn for people to understand it. And a good example of a director changing style is David Cronenberg. Like, he did horror films, like really, like, gross body horror films, and now he does dramas. You know, he completely changed his style and wanted to do something different. And every film he makes now is a drama, but he always adds something as a reference to his older films, which I think is really clever. But I mean, don't get me wrong, I think you're always going to get the Hollywood formula of just, you know,
they got like Transformers.
Exactly, yeah.
Like, Michael Bay sticks to the formula, but that's what, I will give him credit, he's good at doing sticking to the formula.
Yeah.
He knows what people want to see in a big action, explosions.
Exactly, yeah.
They want to see the same thing.
They want to see that, but like, he that's what, like, Michael Bay's not going to change it up.
Oh, no.
He's sticking to that formula.
Because he makes so much money from it.
Bam.
Yeah. But it works though for him.
Yeah, it does work for him. Yeah, lamppost explosions and.
But that's like the difference. Like, there is that still there, but then you do get the more artsy films
there
now, and there's a lot more of them now.
And
mainstream cinemas as well.
Being in Game was very good. You've seen that.
Yeah, Being in Game was something different.
Yeah,
it
was
done, like,
something like.
It was a bit more different.
Yeah. And I mean, you always get look at Nicholas Winding Refn as a director. He made Drive. You know, that was a mainstream film. Fair enough, there are some people that don't like the film, but
maybe 10, 20 years ago, that wouldn't have been released in mainstream films because it was an independent indie film.
Yeah.
But now more indie films are being released in mainstream cinemas.
I think, like, directors like, you know, Kevin Smith and Tarantino for breaking that whole independent, because, you know, Tarantino pretty much was an independent director, and so was Kevin Smith. And then I think, thanks to their popularity, they can learn the indie scene, blow up, and still is
pretty
going
popular,
strong
yeah.
today.
Yeah. It depends on the movie genre, really.
Yeah.
Because there is directors that, you know, key focus is, you know, we need a good character. If you don't have a good character, well, then the plot's going to fall.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I find it, like, you know, obviously depending on the genre, like some characters aren't as memorable as they were. Maybe that's a nostalgic thing, but like I feel that like, you know, the main character from that's Tech Transformers, for example. You know, I'm not connected to them at all. Yeah, like
you don't have a connection to the characters.
Even though you spent 3 films with them, you still
don't care.
Yeah. But like, if you did,
oh yes,
nah,
exactly, yeah. Exactly.
But then if you look at like the Revenant,
yeah,
like that's solely like, you have to get in depth with that character.
Yeah,
like if you don't like that character, you're not gonna like.
Oh yeah, you don't like that.
Like,
oh yeah,
there you gotta get your Oscar. Yeah.
It's like yeah,
burn
it through. But you basically have to go full out on it.
Oh definitely, yeah. Yeah. I mean if you, I actually feel it's like same with Gone Girl. If you don't like
the character,
you're not gonna like the film. Yeah, but I feel like there are some films out there that like, you know, if you don't like the characters, it's still an hate them. But that's kind of the charm of the film. Like, I know it's not a film, but like in Breaking Bad, for example, you know, near the end, right. Walter White became this horrible, terrible person, but you still rooted for him.
Even kind of like Nightcrawler or Jake Gyllenhaal.
Exactly,
like,
yeah.
He was awful, like,
that's
dragging
right.
the bodies to make a better scene in the film.
That's right.
But like, it was so interesting to watch, because like, watching this person do that.
Exactly, or Hannibal even.
You do need Hannibal, yeah.
You actually need to like the bad guys for once.
Yeah,
yeah.
You kind of want to see if they're going to get away with it.
Yeah.
So
and they do now, like, that's something you wouldn't see, like, maybe 30 years ago.
Oh,
like, the good guy always wins, but now there's movies where the kind of bad guys win.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
The people are starting to favourite more towards the anti-hero.
Because they're more interesting to watch.
Yeah.
Because somehow do better, you know how it's going to go with an anti-hero, they can switch sides at any time.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like
yeah.
Deadpool.
Like, that's kind of why Deadpool broke the superhero mold.
Yeah.
Not only was it the first R-rated film superhero film in a long time.
That's right, yeah.
But it done so well because he wasn't your normal, typical, like, you know, do good, I'm going to beat the bad guy to see the person.
Even compared to other, like, Marvel films like years ago, like Blade, for example, like it was really the attempt. But Blade was still a character, he was still a good guy, even though he was, you know.
Even though he just killed.
He killed so much vampires, but he was still a good guy, but he got Deadpool, which is just like, he doesn't care kind of thing.
He's like, fuck you guys.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. Zack Snyder is the best example. style over substance.
Yeah.
Man of Steel. Right, Zach, you get the point. Superman is ultimately, we can beat him. You had to destroy Metropolis and City.
And I love the whole God symbolism in that film. Like every scene, it was just like, I'm God.
But like,
you know,
like Batman vs Superman, right? I did not like the film, but like, I will give him like the opening scene with Bruce Wayne's parents.
Yeah,
that was beautifully shot. Like, he does know how to create a scene.
Oh yeah,
like, he just can't get a script right.
The thing is about Zack Snyder is like, I totally believe he's a visionary, but he could not write a story for shit or direct a film.
Did Christopher Nolan or someone not write that script? Or did
no, no.
I think it was all.
It was like David Goyer with Zack Snyder.
Oh, that's why.
Because, you know, actually, speaking of Christopher Nolan, that's an amazing director who can
that
write a story.
Who can write a story because he actually puts in the time and effort.
Interstellar, the Prestige, Dark Knight. Trilogy.
Even in Interstellar, up until the ending of Interstellar, that entire, like, that whole thing is completely plausible. It's based on the most accurate science.
That's
actually,
right.
Until the end.
That's right.
You mean the parallel?
Yeah, this until that, because, like, that's all.
Oh, yeah, that's theoretical.
That's all of the theory,
that's
all
theoretical.
But I mean, like, don't get me wrong, I think there are directors that do it right. There are some directors that
James
do style over substance very well. Yeah. and Lars von Trier, his films are very, very style over substance, like Antichrist, for example, but he does it extremely well. I think it depends the director in a way.
And William is doing it, George Lucas.
George Lucas is
Stuff. Especially the prequels are concerned, he just didn't care about the characters. Even,
no.
Even the CGI now looks awful. He just wanted to. He even said that he wanted everything CGI'd and everything was CGI. The clone troopers, not them, was a real person.
That's right.
All those clone troopers were.
That's right.
Were all CGI'd.
In the prequels, yeah.
That's why they look funny.
Yeah.
Yeah,
they're
all CG.
In the prequel, in the original trilogy, it was all like uniforms and stuff, but no,
it was cheaper.
Wasn't it something like 90% off the prequel trilogy? It was all done on green screen?
It was all done on green screen, yeah. There was
money
in the set.
That would drive me to, I would leave.
And even like some of the actors came out from, what do you call it, who wanted to use actor?
Ian McGregor.
Yeah, even he came out and said that, like, there's a difference between acting in an actual scene, in a set, and some green screen. Because he said that when you're acting in front of a green screen, there's no emotion.
Yeah.
Looks nothing real. You know, you're just staring at a blue screen. You know, you can't get enveloped in the story. As an actor,
and
you know,
he wants to come back to Star Wars.
Yeah. Oh well, yeah. Because
I think he should.
He definitely should.
From now, what they're doing with Star Wars now, they are doing better stories than what the prequels were like.
Yeah.
I
think that's the best example of Star Wars. Is the prequels, you know, because it's just like, who cares about story? Let's just make pretty visuals.
Definitely positive.
Yeah.
Now, because you're able to get more character development out here, and there's a lot more demand in the actors now than there was a while ago.
Yeah,
like they're actually doing stuff now. Like even Leonardo DiCaprio, like he was actually out in that wilderness.
That's right. I was just about to say that.
He had to crawl through the trees and everything. So like they're actually doing more work now.
And yeah, he had to go and endure that cold water.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
all of that was real, and even the director of the film even said that, like, if we did this as a normal film, a set and everything, you know, fake basically, with lighting and everything, he said it would have been a terrible film. He said if we did not use that real environment, that film would not be good. That's why, I think that's why he did it, because he trained, you know,
so
brought the actors to these harsh environments.
Were they really out in snow?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Freezing?
Yeah.
Yep. All of that was real, you know. That's why a lot of the actors came out and said that, like, you know, we didn't have a good time filming this, but the director was just like, I know you didn't, but that's why the film works so well, you know, because like if we, because I think one of his quotes is like, if we all sat around drinking coffee and laughing, then we would have been a film. That's a quote from him.
Yeah.
And he's totally right.
Like, you need to get down and actually make it real.
Yeah, definitely. I mean,
and like that's why a lot of films are a lot better today, because someone do want to go out and be real.
Exactly.
Back then, when it was the 80s, practical effects were the big thing. In the 90s, digital took over, and practical work was like non-existent.
Yeah.
But now practical's coming back.
Yeah.
People want practical because it looks better. It's more expensive. It's harder, but it looks better.
Oh yeah.
And it feels more real. And that's why practical's coming back, which I think is good.
Yeah, I think that's amazing, because look at the works of The Thing. You know, the original John Carpenter's The Thing.
Yeah.
It's some of the best practical work you'll ever see.
And then
it's
as soon as
fantastic.
He was like the guy who did it,
mm-hmm.
he was considered a god in the 80s because the most advanced practical effects ever made. Since the 90s came, digital took over, he was gone.
Yep, he was out of the job.
He was gone.
I don't even think he does.
No,
anything,
he was
anything
gone.
Anymore.
Most of them are actually gone.
Yeah. The person who created the alien puppet, like who actually created the alien puppet for the first movie, I don't think he does anything.
Yeah, a lot of them do, but
now
it's come back, some of them are.
I think they had to learn a big lesson there with CGI. They probably thought, you guys don't need this anymore, we're going to use CGI.
People also do give CGI a hard time, but you need both. You need practical and CGI to work together,
well,
and then you can create something new.
If they're blended together seamlessly, it's unbelievable. You know, like, I mean, another great example of like practical effects is like Blade Runner, with all those sets made, you know, and like that's why I love the new Blade Runner film, is because they're actually using practical effects and everything. I mean, if they did that in CG, it would be lost. You know, I would still see the film obviously, but something would be lost, I think, if they didn't do practical. You could have, you know, the best acted, well shot film of all time, but if you give it to a crap editor, I mean,
it's gonna fall apart.
It's gonna be an absolute mess.
You need to know when to cut. You need to have the time down.
Yeah.
And that's when the video editor comes in. Like they need to know right from cut there. No, right, use this scene because it seamlessly cuts that. You can't just have slap it together.
Yeah, because it's not gonna make sense, and it's gonna have that massive disjointed. It's gonna be basically disjointed.
Out of place, you know, in the most of the characters. No.
Exactly.
Yeah. Whereas if it's done properly, it's all beautifully crafted together, and you feel what the characters feel when you feel you're in the film.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's a scene you can get off Terminator 2 with someone like re-editing the film to see, you know, how the importance of editing. I think I saw it on YouTube, and it's just so jerky and it doesn't flow well at all, and it's quite a good thing to see actually, because it shows you the importance of editing. You know, and I think editing itself is an art form, definitely.
So it's important to James Cameron.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Well, when it was good.
Yeah, Avatar.
Avatar came about, 3D was starting to come back.
Yeah.
But then, you know, like, still, even though 3D's still out there, people don't really care and don't go see it, still, no. They'd rather go see it 3D.
I remember when I was younger, I loved 3D, and then since Avatar, it worked because that film was made to be in 3D.
And it wasn't bloody the blue and red glasses.
Exactly, it wasn't the blue and red glasses, you actually got like, good.
So that's something that wasn't Spy Kids 3.
Yeah. with the blue and the red glasses. But now I feel that like it is a gimmick because those films, some films that are released in 3D aren't supposed to be.
They aren't supposed to be in 3D.
Attack, what do
you
call that? Attack Titans? Yeah. Clash of the Titans.
Clash of the Titans, sorry. It didn't work. Yeah. But like, there is films that do work in 3D, like Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
Amazing 3D because the film is so visually beautiful. Like,
yeah.
Like, it just looks so good. It looked amazing. Yeah. But like, the film still looked, it's still amazing, but with 2D.
Yeah.
I'd still rather go see it in 2D, but
majority of the time, like, I forget that I'm watching a 3D film.
Yeah, there is time for you to
say. Oh, yeah, yeah.
For you watching 3D film.
One good film I watched in 2D, which was a surprise, was The Final Destination. It was quite good in 3D, because I'd seen there were bits of the car parts.
Oh, yeah, with the
I blinked.
Yeah.
It was
I mean, there are some. Yeah, I think there are some things that are good in 3D,
like,
but it's not a gimmick.
It's not, no one really cares anymore.
Yeah.
When Avatar did it, it was like a big thing because it was popular. But like, no one really cares anymore.
Yeah.
It still doesn't get the respect it should. I think
no one really wants to use it either.
No, because I think they realize like how much a 3D ticket costs now.
It only works at a small scale, I think.
Yeah. If a film is.
It's only usually a film is only in 3D if it's going to be a big blockbuster like Star Wars. They released them in 3D. They released them other movies in 3D. But like any other films, they release in 3D.
Yeah, like I mean, if someone said to me, "Oh, do you want to see like Reservoir Dogs in 2D or 3D?" I would say, "Well, obviously 2D." You know, yeah, that's just my personal preference. But like, I do prefer a 2D.
Yeah, I'd rather watch a 2D film.
Yeah, and then of course they tried the whole 3D DVD thing. Which I don't think ever took off. You know, they released DVDs in 3D and they don't work.
Because like, like when you're at home, you're like, I don't want to sit in like half the
glasses on.
I just want to like kind of be light on, you know.
Unwatchable.
Yeah. Depends for me what film it is. If I think the film's going to be like. Like, I'm glad I went to see Martin Scorsese's new film, Silence, in the cinema, because it was so, you wanted to see that amazing, like, scenery he did, like, in the big screen. It would still be good at home, but, like, I think there's certain films.
You wanted to see it in high quality?
I wanted to see it, like, at its best, because I know it was going to be visually beautiful. It really depends the film, really. Like, I'm not gonna go see an Adam Sandler movie in cinema. I'll watch the DVD. Like, I'll torrent that for good.
Yeah.
I don't want to pay for his films, but like, it depends what film it is. If it's going to be like a beautiful cinematography film, or like maybe like a boozy Star Wars, because I want to see like big amazing effects.
Yeah. I'll always choose cinema. I think I always loved going to the cinema.
Just like going to the cinema, eating popcorn, sitting down, like
and go with film. A few friends. Yeah, I mean it is an experience within itself, and I think that. No, since
it's not as respected.
It's nowhere near as respected, and I think eventually cinemas will get shut down, and it's all just going to be on demand. And I hate that. I hate the fact when we see, you know, in about 10 years, maybe 20 years, when we see a new film come out, it'll just be direct on TV, you know, direct on Amazon, Netflix, Amazon Prime. Netflix, yeah, it's just I hate that.
You're gonna miss the cinema experience.
Yeah, because it is experience, like.
Yeah, it's how you
getting together and watching this amazing movie on
and
the
then walking out and talking about it. I mean. It's experience. It's been an experience for like over 100 years, and we're gonna miss that. But I just think it's the. I don't know what it is. I think it's a combination of like both the cinema, it costs too much for people. You know, tickets cost too much, and also it's time as well.
People don't want to have to go out. They just want to be able to sit
inside.
Home and do it,
But I still think, you know, if something comes out in the cinema, I will go.
I'll still go and see films in the cinema.
Definitely.
So,
and I will keep supporting the cinema as long as. Stays around.
Yeah, petition going to keep cinema going.
Yeah, I actually think people will start to do that. You know, I think
protest.
I mean Tarantino.
Yeah,
completely agrees with the whole cinema thing. He says like once cinema goes, you know, he's done. You know, he doesn't do
fucking anymore.
Because he loves the cinema. You know.
Yeah.
He loves the experience of going to cinema. You know, but he is a traditionalist. You know, he shoots one film.
And he's going to make 10 films and that's it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which I hope he sticks to, because I think 10 films is good to go on.
Can't talk a fair club.
I would say it's a tie between Drive and Fight Club, but I think I'd go for Fight Club.
I don't know. I just go for Fight Club just because I just think it's in the, like, obviously there's films like I love equal to it, but I don't know, Fight Club just has something there.
Fight Club is always
just, I think it's, there's something about, I know, it's not here, it is the visuals.
Yeah.
And there's something about Brad Pitt and, you know, the fellow Edward Norton. There's something about them.
They just work so well together.
I love it.
I just love the story as well. I just thought it was so unique.
Yeah.
Well.
I wonder how many times Edward Norton hurt himself on that
many. Oh, yeah, he really hurt himself that. I mean, there's a scene in that film where they're, doing that scene where they're hitting golf balls at a truck. That was actually real. They were actually drunk and they were hitting golf balls at the camera crew in their van. So yeah, there's loads of trivia about that film. I mean, and what I love about it is like it was such a sleeper hit because when it came out, it got really mixed reviews. In fact, it was seen to be a complete failure, and it didn't make any money in the box office. And in fact, many people protested the film because people thought it encouraged violence. It doesn't. And even there was a senator, or a mayor maybe in America who said we need to ban this film. They actually spoiled the ending for that film. They spoiled everything. And you know, Fincher was raging. He said that was a waste of time. It wasn't until that film came out in DVD in about 2001 maybe, it became this cult film, and then it got reevaluated and it's not really an absolute masterpiece. And
Last laugh then?
Yeah, he got the last laugh basically. And even Chuck Palahniuk, who did the Fight Club book, he came out and said it's better than my book.
Yeah, he said it's better than his book.
Yeah,
he said he liked the film better than his own book.
Yeah, he said like if I had a choice between reading my own book again or watching the film, I'd choose the film again.
You know you're succeeding if you beat the author.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I think actually, speaking of David Fincher, he is the best person to do book adaptations because it's worked every time.
Yeah, he is good.
Oh, I like Alien 3.
There's so many. But like then it's really hard to choose because there's bad films. Like there's films that are made to be bad, and then there's films that are made to be good but end up being bad.
Yeah.
And I think films that aiming to be good but end up being bad are worse than the films made to be bad. Like.
This
is just my hatred for Zack Snyder, but I despise Sucker Punch. I think it was one of the worst films I've ever seen in my entire life. I just thought it was visually it was alright, but I just thought the whole story was pointless, meaningless. It just droped on, and it was just an awful experience. Like I would have rather watched a film made to be purposely bad, like Mega Shock versus Crocosaurus. Down Sucker Punch, because at least that film is made to be bad.
What about Sharkboy and Lava Girl?
Well, Sharkboy and Lava Girl was. Sharkboy and Lava Girl was specifically made to appeal to children's age, like 5 to six, basically. It is an awful film. Like it's an awful, but I don't believe that film had ever any intention to be good. he just made that film because for money and for kids.
I definitely think that.
Of people like Donald Trump.
What's the worst film I've seen? God, it's too many.
Just name one. And we'll go from there.
Was it Birdemic? I would say Birdemic.
Birdemic
because
Hitchcock film.
No, that's the
birds. Hey, this was a. He calls it a remake. film.
Most badly acted film you've ever seen.
It is the worst film, probably of all time. Because I know it's known to be this cult. Haha, it's so bad, it's good. But the director, he still thinks he's making a masterpiece, and he's not.
He wanted to make a masterpiece, but it ended up being the worst thing ever. It was awful.
It's not even pretentious. It's just his ego. Like he says, like kind of like the way of all. Yeah. Actually, you know what? Birdemic, or just pick any Uwe Boll film.
Uwe Boll believes he's the greatest filmmaker ever.
Yeah.
But he makes the worst films ever.
Oh, yeah. You can't take this to be a piece of crap.
He's
if you criticise him, he wants to fight you.
Oh, he does?
You fed him in the ring.
And he's never lost a fight. The German government finally shut down his film studio because, it's not making any money.
Well, they're getting any profit here.
Yeah, so I think he's actually done making films now.
Hopefully,
apparently he's coming back.
Apparently, maybe come back, but pray he's not coming
back. Someone actually signed a petition for Uwe Boll to stop making films.
To stop making films, and he looked at them and he started like swearing and shouting, like, oh no, I am the greatest filmmaker ever.
Yeah.
I am the greatest.
Plan 9 from Outer Space.
Oh, yeah, anything from Ed Wood.
People consider that such a cult film, though.
Yeah.
I mean, people love watching Plan. It's like, but like, there's movies that are fun to watch because they're bad. Like
Tim Burton's Ed Wood.
Or The Room with Tom Wiseau.
Yeah.
That film is really awful. Nothing about that film is good.
No.
But it's funny to watch because it's bad.
Yeah. Because I'd rather have a funny bad film, like you can laugh because it's so bad, than just a blatantly this is crap film.
Have you seen Graven Crackers?
I have heard of it.
I have heard of it. Bad.
It's so bad it's good.
Oh yeah.
It's an awful film.
It's brilliant. It's so good, you can't stop watching it.
There's another person, and I can't remember his name, but he's getting more popularity now in the whole so bad is good thing, and he's made like a trilogy of films, and they're absolutely hilarious. What he did for like one of his films, he bought loads of broken laptops off eBay so he can just destroy them in the film. Like, there's a scene where he's like, oh, I feel so faint, and then he just goes, oh no, and like he purposely throws the laptop off the table, like it's dreadful. I can't remember his name though, but...
I think what they should do with some of the, like what they used to do more often was like, they'd hold like a big screening, invite loads of people around, then they'd fill out these forms and then give them back to the studio for criticism.
Yeah.
But they don't do that as much, they don't do that anymore. It's kind of like a dead form of getting feedback. Usually it's just a select screening with like at a Sundance or something.
Usually
film, basically almost done, and then they'd finish it really.
Exactly.
But they wouldn't really take any criticism on board. Mm-hmm. I think they need to listen to people, but
definitely
they never will.
I mean,
they won't really.
I mean, some directors just will not change. I think.
Yeah, they're
like Michael Bay.
Zack Snyder's not.
Yeah, Zack Snyder's not going to change.
Well, I also want more practical effects being used in films.
Yeah,
more Star Wars.
I would like to see, better horror film being
not just
your stereotypical
Bob zombie
supernatural. you've got a supernatural ghost now.
Yeah,
it's not even a killer anymore. It's always a ghost now.
Yeah,
repetitive Walking Dead episodes.
You've got found footage films, and just someone needs to look at horror films and just. I don't know, just make something.
That's what James Wan is trying to do.
Yeah.
At least James Wan probably like the only good horror filmmaker out there.
Yeah. Because
he actually cares.
There's some films in the French extreme scene, which is pretty good, like Martyrs and Switchblade Romance. But yeah, I mean, we're not really getting any good mainstream
films. You don't get
like the last one I can think of is like The Conjuring. And it was really good. Yeah. Like, I really like The Conjuring, but apart from The Conjuring.
Yeah, just before that, Scream. So
I mean, Scream.
I like the first.
Yeah, like the first Scream.
I liked it because it was really meta.
Yeah.
It was different. It was a horror comedy.
It was like a parody of all.
It was a parody of itself.
And Scream was like, you want to see a f***ing party?
Yeah.
And Scream was a parody of a parody. So.
Yeah, that's right. Actually,
it
was a parody.
And then Scream became a parody of itself.
Yeah, and then it became horrible. I'd like to see more.
I like to see a bit more horror films being put in the mainstream.
Yeah. Because I think
not just your classic Friday the 13th Halloween release.
Yeah.
Of horror movies though. I would like to see a horror movie go one scene in the summer. I like to see
doing
put animation instead of Halloween.
Yeah, exactly, because there's so much trashy horror films that are out there, and I think that it's I don't know. It just seems like it's the cliches of jump scares. I think actually needs to be done is there needs to be a really, really amazing director out there that makes horror film. I would love to see Tarantino make a horror film.
Oh yeah.
Because
yeah,
you would get insane amount of gore and amazing dialogue. You know what I mean? Like it would totally be a 180.
That's probably
what he done.
That might end up being his last film.
Yeah, and I'd love for him to do that.
I think really the horror genre is the only thing that needs to come back. Because all you know, you've got all these other genres
yeah.
coming back. You know, you've got like sci-fi coming back doing really well.
Yeah, you've got
and, like
art films doing pretty good.
Yeah, but the horror does not get the recognition it should. Like back
yeah.
in the '80s, horror was like the biggest thing in genres
yeah,
out there.
Freddy Krueger,
Halloween. You had Halloween.
Had to like first.
You
like
had
Avengers.
You had everything.
Yeah.
The two of them would have done together.
Yeah. And then you got like a mixture of genres. You've got Alien, which was horror, sci-fi horror.
If that version had carried on, you would have probably seen Scream and Jigsaw together.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I would love to see like just way more really quality
good
horror
movies with
yeah.
like interesting stories instead of just your stereotypical. There's a demon out there.
That's why
that's
I think,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah, stuff in the Conjuring series.
Yeah, I mean, they're milking them to death. I mean, how many actresses films is
a lot.
A lot.
TV series is actually good.
Yeah.
Because it interlocked with the original.
Maybe that's what they need, you know, instead of making films, horror films, they make horror TV shows.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, TV is really good.
Films only have, like, 90 minutes to make something decent, whereas a TV series shows that they have time to develop.
Yeah.
And create scripts to go along and then the finale.
Boom.
And then that
yeah.
big boom carries on.
Yeah.
Great and bad, don't it?
Yeah.
I think that, you know, what's going to kill the horror, or it has killed the horror in mainstream remakes. You know, not to beat a dead horse to death, but.
It just shows that
you need more original.
Remakes, you know, there's only a few horror remakes that are actually decent. You know, you've got The Thing, you've got. I mean, I like the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake.
Did you watch The Collector?
I did watch The Collector, yeah, that was good.
Yeah,
that was good. But yeah, horror needs to come back.
That's really the thing.
Big way.
It's starting to come back, really, you know. Sci-fi is starting to come back.
But also action films.
Slowly making its way back in, but I don't think it has the people.
It hasn't grabbed as many people's attention.
People are still bashing the horror. It's all
it's all
yeah.
Then if we, not maybe we would give Saw a chance.
Yeah.
You know, because that was at the stage where everyone was sick of horror
yeah,
because
yeah.
it's the same crap. Then the one good horror comes out, and most people are like,
we don't care, kind of thing.
Yeah. And then eventually it went to heaven as well. And people like, see, I was right, and watch it, but I was right, and now they all hear
it. I also think sequels kill horror as well. I mean,
yeah.
How many times can you make something like Sky? It's all.
There's
all
only so many times, jeez, come back.
Yeah,
yeah
exactly. I would actually love for them to be, like, to resurrect the whole Friday the 13th thing one last time and make the best one and then kill it forever. You know, just to go out on something really good.
The destroyed
you know?
Resident Evil.
Oh yeah. Oh, I mean,
like
it was never.
I never
oh,
liked
God.
It because it just. But mainly because I didn't like it because like it took away
crap.
Everything from the game.
Yeah.
So for
it could have been it could have
it
been
made,
a really
it
good.
Made a survival horror game into an
action
film.
The animation for probably better.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, even the cutscenes in the games were better.
They were closer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because they actually stuck to the original characters.
Yeah. And actually, George Romero was actually originally going to make for the first Resident Evil film. He actually wrote a script, and he sent it to Capcom. And Capcom were like, nope, we're going to go with Paul. What's his name?
Paul W.S. Anderson.
Mortal Kombat.
Resident Evil, all this other stuff.
He made Mortal Kombat 2 as well, Annihilation, which was even worse.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he could have had George Romero, the person who made Dawn of the Dead, but no.
I think that would have been better. I think George Romero could have given it that Resident Evil look and feel.
Oh, definitely. In fact, he made a trailer for Resident Evil 2, and you can look at that on YouTube, and it's pretty good looking.
Did not know that. I looked it up.
Yeah, it's a live action like Resident Evil 2 trailer. He made that, and that's what was, that was his like promo video for the movie.
Yeah,
was really
like
good
calling cards, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
This
is what I was wearing.
Fans want.
And it was
no,
really
we
good.
Want this guy who has nothing to do Resident Evil to do us.
He's going to completely mess up Resident Evil.
Yeah.
He's going to make it completely different.
Well, that's what we want.
Yeah. And they made, like, you know, the first film, it was just like, right, this is ridiculous. And the second film, as time went on, it just got more
it
ridiculous.
It got progressively
worse. I loved the first film. I did, I thought it was class.
I did.
But the second and third one, I was like,
And the fourth and fifth, I go,
fourth and that's like, I hate you. The fifth one, I am not watching
the sixth one.
Yeah, the sixth one
is
the last one.
Six. They say it's the last one, but I'm done. Like, but that's a movie that would get on.
After the scene in the third film, I believe, where she can light birds on fire with her eyes.
Yeah.
I was like, what
about it? It's when the start. The song from Magical Powers.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. After I saw that, I was like, what am I watching? Like, what has this got to do with anything? Like, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying Resident Evil has the best story lines because they don't, and they're hilarious. But at least they were scary. At least they had atmosphere to them. And the movies just strip all that away from, like.
Yeah. Like, her characters were likable, but.
Even if they made, like, the film so bad it's good, like, you know, getting the voice actor from the first Resident Evil and making that into a film, that would be way more entertaining. With that terrible voice acting, I would watch that.
Reboot and get George Romero back.
Yeah. Oh well, George Romero's track record isn't as good now.
Why?
Well, he made Diary of the Dead.
No, he just made it. He tried to drive out of the Dead franchise, and it just didn't work out. It got progressively worse and worse and worse.
Yeah, he made Land of the Dead, which wasn't great. He made Diary of the Dead, which is probably the worst zombie film I've ever seen in my life. And then Survival of the Dead, which is zombie cowboys, like.
Oh gee, what happens when they reach that stage?
To be fair, remember he's like 78 now. Like, he's good.
That's how much.
They'll probably start believing me, Dracula or something.
Right, I want you to calm down. This is going to play Nemesis in Resident Evil.
This is heaven's different. George, what about 789? They don't exist.
But yeah, I think horror movies come back in a massive way. Yeah, there are a few good films in horror, but not. Like, I'm sure there's a great horror film with the Conjuring, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I saw the Carrie remake, and it was god awfully bad.
Chloe Grace Moretz.
I
like her as an actress. I think there's times where she's really good. Like, I love her in the first Kick-Ass.
Yeah, I liked her in the first Kick-Ass. I didn't like her in the second Kick-Ass.
I didn't like her in Dishonored.
I did like voice actors as well.
I felt different, but I love Dishonored.
No, I like Dishonored. I didn't like her as a voice actor. That was my
Hitchcock!
Back
here.
I know, we need to resurrect Hitchcock, so you hide a mega film. We need George on his back.
No!
We need him on Star Wars episode 8. The return of Jar Jar. Like. So, in conclusion, screw you a ball.
Screw mainstream Hollywood blockbusters like Transformers.
Yeah.
Indie films are the best right now.
Yes, indie films.
That's true, because they're actually trying to make a good
Try and make a good film that you need.